Do the habits and preferences of my students actually say something about how well they'll perform on exams? I had a hunch, and more importantly, I had data to test it. At the start of the semester, I gave my students a 9-question survey, the same one from our earlier video on dot products. Most students put their real names on the survey, which meant I could match their responses to their midterm scores. One question in particular, whether they're early preppers or last-minute crammers, seemed like a strong contender for predicting performance. So I used linear algebra to investigate. If you've studied statistics, you might recognize this as a multiple regression problem, but today we're tackling it from a linear algebra perspective. Along the way, we'll derive the normal equation, a core formula used in data science and machine learning to fit regression models, and finally solve the class of problems we've been calling best approximation problems. Predicting a student's midterm score from their survey items is a kind of problem we've referred to as a best approximation problem. If we think of the answers to each question as a vector, then we can think of this prediction problem as trying to find the linear combination of the question vectors that creates a new vector that is the best approximation to the midterm vector. All best approximation problems have the same structure. We have a set of vectors that we can call basis vectors, which we use to get the closest to the goal vector. Geometrically, we're trying to find the point in the span of the basis vectors that is closest to the goal vector. We learned in previous videos that the span of one non-zero vector is a line, two linearly independent vectors is a plane, three linearly independent vectors is a 3D hyperplane, equivalent to what we think of as 3D space. It continues on, but since it is hard to represent higher dimensions geometrically, we could use a two-dimensional plane to represent the span in a three-dimensional space, or a one-dimensional span, which is a line, to represent the span in a 2D space, and we will use the latter since it's easier to see geometrically. And here is the goal vector, which does not live in the span of the basis vectors. The best approximation to the goal vector, using only vectors within the plane, is the shadow it casts onto the plane, also known as its projection. If we can find an algebraic way of representing these two vectors, the shadow and the vector orthogonal to the plane pointing to the head of the goal vector, the solution to our problem is the coefficient of these basis vectors that create this projected vector. We can use what we know about dot products and orthogonal vectors to set up an equation and solve for the coefficients. The projected vector is a linear combination of basis vectors, but we learned that linear combinations of vectors can be represented as a matrix multiplication times a vector, with the columns of the matrix being our basis vectors and the vector being the corresponding coefficients of the basis vectors. We will call the matrix with our preference survey answers A. It has 9 columns, one for each survey question. Since we don't know the coefficients of these vectors to create our projected vector, we will call the vector of coefficients X bar. Finding the entries to X bar will solve our problem. Now the projected vector, which we'll call point P, can be written as AX. Let's call the vector from the head of P to the head of the goal vector D. D for difference, because we can calculate this vector as a difference between P and the goal vector. Vectors P and D are orthogonal to each other because P is an orthogonal projection of the goal vector down to the plane. This is the key piece of information that we can use to set up an equation to solve for X bar. The dot product of two orthogonal vectors is 0, so the dot product of P and D is 0. Now we can replace D and P with the expressions in terms of the goal vector G and A and X bar. Now all we have to do is solve for X bar in this equation. But how do we solve a matrix equation? We use matrix algebra. I assume you are familiar with solving algebraic equations from secondary school. Well, luckily the process for solving matrix equations is basically the same. However, there are a few important differences because matrices have different properties than real numbers. And here are the 4 big ones. First, is that we don't divide by matrices. Instead of dividing, we multiply by the inverse matrix. It's also important to remember that not all matrices have inverses. Only square matrices with linearly independent columns have inverses. In practice, we might solve an equation assuming a square matrix has an inverse, then in a particular application, check to make sure that it is the case. This is similar to solving equations for real numbers using square roots and checking that the value under the radical is non-negative for a particular case. Second, matrix multiplication is not commutative. If we switch the order of the factors in a matrix product, we are not guaranteed to have the same product. That means we can't move matrices around like in this expression of A, B, A inverse to get the A and the A inverse together to multiply to get the identity matrix. It also means that when solving, we have to be careful to multiply the matrix on the same side of the expressions on both sides of the equation. For example, in solving AX equals B, we can write this, but not this. We're not even sure if the product on the right is even defined, let alone equal to the product on the left. Third, dot products are only for vectors, not for matrix products. So dot products need to be turned into an equivalent matrix product. For example, we can write the dot product of two vectors like this or this. And that's just fine. But if we drop the dot from the middle, then this notation implies the matrix multiplication process. And in neither case is this even defined. We have some work to do to convert dot products to matrix products, and it involves transposing one of the vectors. We can represent the transpose with the superscript T. So U dot V is the same as U transpose V, if U and V are column vectors. Finally, the transpose operation has properties of its own. The product of AB is a vector. If we transpose that vector, we're transposing the entire product. But it would be nice to know how to write this without parentheses. We might take a guess that AB transpose is the same as A transpose B transpose. But we can test that with some random values for A and B and find that isn't the case. If we do some algebra, we can find that AB transpose is the same as B transpose A transpose. So we need to swap the order when distributing the transpose operation. About all other operations in solving matrix equations match the process when solving real-valued equations, so your intuition shouldn't let you down. Matrix algebra is a key part of linear algebra and a very powerful tool for scientists, economists, engineers, statisticians, mathematicians, and others. For example, you can see the central role it has in papers like this one from Lindley and Smith, which helps us understand how to do regression when certain assumptions for ordinary least squares regression are violated. Now let's start applying these to solve for x bar in our equation. We can start by writing the dot product as matrix products with our transpose operator, by transposing AX since we're assuming our vectors are column vectors. Now we can distribute the transpose operator by switching the order of A and X bar. We can now distribute over the subtraction to get two expressions. And now we cry a little bit. It looks like we're making things worse. It's hard to see how we can isolate X bar. Well, let's pull the right expression over to the right side and have another look. Well, when is the left-hand side equal to the right-hand side? There are two cases. AX has to equal G. Remember that AX is the projection of our goal vector down to the span of our basis vectors. So for AX to equal G, then G needs to be in the span of the columns. This is no longer a best approximation problem if this is the case. This is equivalent to solving a system of equations, and we can solve by row reducing, or in the case where A is square, finding the inverse. However, chances are with real-world data that G will not be in the span. So that won't help us. The second case is this case, where A transpose G equals A transpose AX. This is a situation where we can solve for X. A transpose A is always a square matrix, and if the columns of A are linearly independent, then A transpose A is invertible. So we can solve by multiplying by the inverse of A transpose A on the left of both sides of the equation. The left side now holds a straightforward equation for calculating x bar, which is the coefficients that we're looking for, from the data matrix A and the goal vector G. What we have derived is called the normal equation. Normal is another word for perpendicular, or orthogonal. It is called the normal equation because it is the solution to the orthogonal projection problem that emerges in best approximation problems. The process we went through was pretty close to the simpler case of projecting one vector onto another, which we did in another video. When we solved the problem, we did not have to know matrix algebra. We just needed to know vector algebra. But both formulas we developed look very similar. If we rewrite the multiplication of A transpose A as a division, and we rewrite U dot U as a matrix product, then we can see the similarities between the two formulas. And this hints that A transpose A is a generalization of a dot product to matrices. Okay. Well, now we can use what we learned to answer my question. Do student preferences predict midterm scores? I did all the calculations in a spreadsheet. You may not know this, but spreadsheets will do matrix commands. To multiply two matrices, use the command mmult, and to find the inverse, use the command minverse. The m at the beginning of these commands stands for matrix. To transpose a matrix, use transpose. Now we can use the matrix of survey responses and the vector of midterm scores and calculate the coefficients of the survey responses that best predict the scores. If we only use these 9 columns, we won't get exactly the coefficients that we would get if we used regression software. That is because regression software defaults to have a constant in the model. We can fix that in our calculations by adding a column of 1s into our data matrix. The constant in the model is the coefficient of the column of 1s. We see that there are a couple of questions that have relatively large coefficients. Since all of these survey responses used the same scale, then the larger the coefficient, the more predictive power of that question on the survey. Well, as I suspected, the early preppers do better than the last-minute crammers. That vector has the largest coefficient. The second largest suggests that those that prefer writing a poem or a song tend to have higher midterm scores than those that prefer to work on a vehicle. That's interesting. What is that all about? I don't know, but if you have thoughts, put them in the comments. If we use a regression program to do the analysis, we see that our coefficients are the same as the regression coefficients, because we both used the same formula, the normal equation, to calculate that vector of coefficients. For those interested, the two variables with the highest coefficients are both statistically significant. Are they practically significant? I'm not so sure. This example is a fun one to explore the linear algebra on, but we've not reached the level of analysis to make this good science, so take the results with a grain of salt. Thank you for watching. Please subscribe and share our videos. Be sure to follow Math the World on Twitter, Instagram, and Facebook. Thank you so much for your support.